a call from Ginger Rogers.
She's not happy with her representation, so who knows?
Phil, it's Rose.
Rose?
Your sister. My son. He's coming to Hollywood. The man eats with Fred Astaire and Gary Cooper.
I'm impressed.
Hey everybody, welcome to What the Flick. Tim Grierson joins us again this week. Alonso Duralde talking about the latest from Woody Allen, which premiered at the Cannes Film Festival, where Tim saw it because he's fancy that way. Cafe Society.
It's very fancy. Yes, this is the latest from Woody Allen. It stars Jesse Eisenberg as a aspiring something. He lives in New York. He moves out to Hollywood in the 1930s to work with his uncle, who's a hotshot agent, played by Steve Carell. He wants to get into the film business. Along the way, he falls in love with Kristen Stewart. Let's take a look.
Hello? Come in. Sit. Christ, man, it's all about ego. This whole town runs on ego.
Yeah, I'm Bobby.
Bonnie, come in here, can you? Bonnie, this is my nephew, Bobby.
How is a two-time Academy Award winner?
Wow, congratulations. Hey,
thank you. You've never heard of me. I'm a writer.
Welcome to Hollywood.
Hey, pal, you bored already?
I'm kind of half bored, half fascinated. My brother Ben owns a nightclub. He's asked me to help him run it.
Let me get know.
Now we have to see if the owner's willing to sell. We're trying to persuade him.
You ask politely, people listen.
Are there more beautiful girls in Hollywood or New York?
Why? Is that how you'll decide where you'll live?
You're very beautiful.
I'm seeing someone.
Oh, unrequited love kills more people in any year than tuberculosis.
Don't you want to try me?
Listen, I'm so lonely. I would have been happy just to talk, but now I'm even too tired for that. You like jazz music?
At 2 in the morning.
At any time in the morning.
Oh, Woody.
before we went on air, I commented to Alonzo that the last time I was on, or one of the last times I was on What the Flick, I was here to talk about Irrational Man. So as the foremost Woody Allen apologist slash sub on What the Flick, I'm happy to be back here.
Well, someone has to speak up for him. This movie feels like just so many cobbled together pieces of other Woody Allen movies. Like the central love triangle reminded me a lot of the one from Manhattan, and Woody narrates it in this really, it sounds like a first take. Like it sounds like a temp track that you edit to, and then, oh, we'll come in later and do the real one. And then they never did. And I mean, you know, when he's obviously, you know, you think of like Annie Hall in Manhattan, like his narration has been great in the past, but it just sort of slumps along. This is such a nothing movie. I mean, the period detail is lovely to look at. There's a few jokes that land. I like Jesse Eisenberg and Kristen Stewart as a screen couple. However, they've made three movies together, and I only like one of them. Right. So I liked Adventureland.
I was doing Adventureland. Not American Ultra. Yeah.
Not American Ultra, although Dave and I argue about that one a lot. And then this one also is just like, I really found this movie just kind of collapsing under its own weight. It's so nothing, and it's just so much of the Woody Allen obsessions about like old Hollywood and white people who love jazz, and you know. I was not into it.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard in certain ways to defend Woody Allen movies against that complaint, because what you say is basically exactly correct. It is similar themes, similar kind of tone and style. As a Woody Allen fan, I will say that I continue to find there to be enough pleasure in this. I think specifically what is interesting in this movie, and I think there's more than a couple things that are interesting, is that this is actually a movie, though it's about LA and New York, and he takes a lot of kind of cracks at Los Angeles, as he is wont to do in his movies. I think that this movie actually argues in a certain way about why Hollywood, or specifically the West Coast, looked so appealing to people who lived on the East Coast in the 1930s. It seemed like this magical place that didn't have cold, terrible winters, and the sun was always out, and there's all these beautiful people. I think, you know, he works with cinematographer Vittorio Storaro in this movie, and I think Storaro does a really great job, and very intentionally, to make all the stuff out in Hollywood look incredibly, impossibly
so
glamorous.
Golden,
yeah. Yeah, I mean, a lot of times, like, you know, New York looks amazing in his movies, but this time it's actually Los Angeles that does. And I think one of the things that's really strong about Cafe Society is it is kind of about the grass being greener somewhere else. Because that Jesse Eisenberg character, what he goes through, I mean, the romantic triangle that you alluded to, is that he's in love with Kristen Stewart. What he doesn't know is that Kristen Stewart is also in love and having a relationship with his uncle, played by Steve Carell. And so there's like this triangle going on. For the most part, the two men don't know.
They're both in
love with the same woman. And so there's a certain amount of like lusting after something that you can't have in this movie, about living in Los Angeles, this kind of amazing place that Jesse Eisenberg sort of an outcast from. And then there are things that happen afterwards that I don't think we should reveal, but they involve him meeting Blake Lively's character, Jesse Eisenberg meeting Blake Lively, and then having in some ways another kind of romantic triangle that goes on in the film. It's not a great Woody Allen movie, and I'm not going to try and sell on being some sort of like undiscovered masterpiece. It is very much in the vein of a lot of his sort of gentle, pleasant recent comedies. It won't like change the Earth's axis, obviously, but I do think it's funny enough. I think Jesse Eisenberg and Kristen Stewart together make a really great couple. I agree it's not as good as Adventureland, but I do think it shows the kind of rapport that they do have on screen. I think in terms of Woody Allen surrogates that we've had over the years, Jesse Eisenberg is actually a pretty decent one. Because I think he gets stronger as the movie goes along, and I think that's intentional. I think at the beginning, he's very much the kind of hemming and hawing Woody Allen surrogate.
Oh, God, there's a scene early on where he has like this awkward scene with a Jewish call girl.
Which is terrible. Which is a terrible scene.
Which is just like textbook bad Woody Allen, you know.
And I will defend it mildly by saying I think that it's supposed to be that he's supposed to be kind of a ineffectual wimp and that he gets stronger. And I think he does.
What
happens is he sort of kind of finds, that character finds his voice, and you notice that he becomes more like Jesse Eisenberg as opposed to Woody Allen as the movie goes along.
No, I agree. Eisenberg, I think, gets the sort of Woody Allen characterizations in a lot of way without having to fall into like an impersonation the way that like Kenneth Branagh or John Cusack or other actors we've seen in that role do over the years. He's got that same sort of wiry, manic, urban energy going, you know. And I think they're a good pairing, and I wish that Woody Allen, writer director, were giving Jesse Eisenberg, Woody Allen surrogate better stuff to do and say. You know?
Yeah, I mean, this is definitely not a Blue Jasmine or a Vicky Cristina Barcelona. I mean, to name two like recent,
Woody
Allen movies. But I do think that the way this movie builds and where it ends, it does touch a theme of his. I still think it's pretty strong, which is the idea of choices that people make and having to kind of live with those choices and how you kind of, in some ways, reconcile yourselves to not exactly getting what you want. Now, again, that's not a new thing. Woody Allen is not kind of breaking the sound barrier in terms of coming up with that as a theme.
Yeah.
But it's a theme that I think means a lot to him. And I think there's a lot of emotional undercurrent to that. And I think it does work enough. Again, this is not a great Woody Allen movie. I think it is a good enough Woody Allen movie.
I did see it back-to-back with The Shallows, so, you know, Blake Lively is having an interesting year, for sure.
Yes. I think Blake Lively is good in this movie.
She's fine, yeah, in a mostly thankless role.
I mean, a little better than thankless, I would say.
As Shiksa savior, basically, in this movie.
She is a bit of attractive woman number 12. Yes. There is very much that.
Yeah. So, all right, what do you say?
I give it a 6.
Okay, I think you're being a little kind. Again,
that's my job here on the show.
It's true. It's why we have you here. No, I'd say 4.5. So for us, that's a 5.3, but it's up to 80% on the Rotten Tomatoes meter, so someone's liking it. Cafe Society opening in theaters. It's not, Amazon produced it, but it's not on Amazon yet, right?
No, it's in New York and Los Angeles, and it'll expand across the country, I believe, July 29th.
Gotcha. All right, so keep an eye out if that's your sort of thing. Thanks for watching.